So hello and welcome. Happy Friday. Today is, if you don't already know, January the 1st of 2021. This is episode number 91. Glad you're here. Hope you're wide awake. Hope your New Year's Eve wasn't too difficult for you. And what are we going to talk about? It's 29 degrees Fahrenheit outside. Snowy, sleety. There's a nice coating of ice everywhere. The bees are snug and tucked away. That is minus 1.6 Celsius for most of you. This is also going to be added to my podcast. So if you don't already know about that, people that have been asking about a podcast, it is called The Way to Be, and it is at podbean.com. If you have troubles remembering that, you can go to my website, www.thewaytobe.org. And there's a page titled Podcast. And guess what? All the current uploads are there. I have currently, are you ready for this number? 15 followers. So don't tell me that's not viral right now. It's out of control, so many followers. And of course, there are 6 episodes. After today, there will be 7. And if there's an episode that we've covered here, and you'd like to have that added to the podcast so you can listen to it while you're riding your bike, mowing, exercising, whatever you're doing, let me know and I'll do it, because it takes no time really to do that. All it is the audio version of what you're watching right now. So welcome if you're new. Look down in the video description to see what we're going to talk about today. Also, I'd like to point out that this is The Way to Be. So I'm glad you're here. If you have a question, please write in the comment section below. If you'd rather not post your comment for everyone to see, please click on the link in the video description that takes you to my website, which has a form for you to fill out, and that gets submitted to me, and we'll consider that potentially for discussion just like today's. What else we have going on? I think that's about it for the introductions. So we're going to get right into it. The questions that we're answering today were submitted during the past week from all over the world, so I appreciate it if you took the time to submit a question for me. The other thing is, not all questions get answered here. Sometimes I reply directly and give you an immediate, quick, short answer. And if your answer doesn't get covered today, that's generally because I either think that a lot of people may not be interested in that specific topic, or it's been well covered before. So we're gonna get right into it. The very first one is from Nancy Tasker, Harleysville, Pennsylvania. And we'll get right into it. I think I'm upwards of 30 or more episodes having been watched. Thank you. Some people have watched every single one. 91 episodes. Could you please talk a little bit about your painting methods and your wax dipping process? Thank you. First of all, we are geared towards backyard beekeeping, which is generally small scale. And I have less than 15 colonies right now, so even my backyard collection is fairly small. And so I don't do the wax dipping. I can send you to people that demonstrate the process. Cayman Reynolds comes to mind. He's a commercial beekeeper. Therefore, he has a huge volume of woodenware and things like that. So he does his own paraffin style dipping and soaks it really hot, and it gets right in there and seals things up. As far as longevity goes, I have no idea how long that stuff is going to last. But guess what I did? I did what I felt a lot of backyard beekeepers are going to do. And I did a review of the Hoover pre-waxed beehive. Very inexpensive, by the way. So in the link below, you can look at my YouTube video. There'll be a link there that takes you to it, because it just was published last week, just a few days ago. I went out there in the freezing cold and I put that thing together. And they have a double dip process. In other words, the first round is paraffin dipping. They have a superheated composition of their wax material, so it's not all beeswax initially, and they dip the woodenware before the pieces go together. Now, that's the other thing when people are dipping in hot wax or whatever. Some people like to assemble the boxes completely, then put it together. Some people assemble or just do the pieces, dip those, then put them together later. So if you do this and you have a preference about that, please write that in the comments below this video so we can see what your experiences are. Feel free to share a link if you've made a video about it. And then their second dip process is, according to them, is 100% beeswax. So the whole kit was very inexpensive and it's dovetailed. And anyway, won't spend a lot of time on it, because actually I made that video for you to see. assembly, links to buy it, free shipping, everything else. And that comes from a company called Galena Farms, but the beehive style is the Huber hive, if you'd like to Google that. So, the other thing is, I like to use marine quality spar varnish on the outside of my beehives if I want to see the wood preserved. So I have several things going on out in the bee yard. No protection whatsoever. So those are cedar hives, because cedar is naturally weather resistant. They have no finish on them whatsoever. The next phase is marine quality spar varnish, which gets used on ships. So I use Helmsman's marine spar varnish, which was used on the Blue Nose 2 schooner. That's all they use on the exterior woodwork. So if that thing is seaworthy and that's what they used, I thought that was good. And then, of course, for paint, I use Valspar, although you can use any exterior grade acrylic paint. I recommend water-based acrylics. And the reason that we bring this up this time of year, because actually this is a great time of year to be painting and finishing the woodenware that you're going to be putting out in your bee yard when spring comes along. Because we want it completely cured. The other thing is, I don't put finishes on the interior surfaces of my hives. And of course, when you dip something like the wax dip that we just talked about, that coats all surfaces, interior, exterior, top, bottom. What I do paint and finish when I'm applying it myself is the exterior surfaces, for one, and the tops and the bottom surface of the box. The interior remains plain wood, and that is because the bees will preserve that. It's not exposed to the elements. It's only exposed to the bees inside, and if they want to propolize it, they can do it. Bees put propolis on the interior joints where the boxes come together, where the corner joints are, where your inner cover meets your top box, and things like that. So they do a really good job of sealing things up from the inside, so I see no need to do that. The other thing is, a lot of people fret about the composition of the material, and they spend a lot of time looking for finishes that are not harmful to bees. Well, a lot of materials could potentially be harmful to your bees while they're in their liquid state, while they're still chemically active. Very few of those approved for household paint, for example, would be harmful once cured, once dry. The other thing is, a lot of people ask, do I prefer heavy coats or many thin coats? Always, when preserving wood, multiple thin coats is superior to a heavy, thick, single coat. So, that's pretty much that. Feldspar, acrylic, latex, semi-gloss. Gloss lasts longer. It's also more expensive. So here's the other thing I do, because I'm a tightwad. I like to use the semi-gloss and for the undercoatings. So for the first couple of layers of paint, then the final coat, that's when I put on the full gloss of the same color paint. So why not save a few pennies there? And then the gloss, actually, if it's super slick, and you paint your landing board, for example, so it's toss-up. Do you really want to paint your landing board? You probably don't have to, and I've seen the bees get blown off the landing board trying to grip it. So if it's super shiny and super smooth on your landing board surfaces, then the bees go to land on it and they have a hard time getting footing to get in there against a wind, for example. So those are just random things to consider. So I have no dipping method because I don't do it, but it is cheap. It was $187 for two deep 10-frame boxes with all the frames, landing board, entrance reducer, inner cover, telescoping top cover, all finished. There's nothing you have to do except take it out of the box, put it together, you're good to go. We don't have a lot of questions today, so this should actually be a short one. So you might be happy, you might not be. Some people ask me to make these as long as possible. So, we just won't rush through it. Next is from David Shrewsbury. I'm a first-year beekeeper, and throughout the summer, my bees have been very gentle and would only sting if I messed up and pinched one. Today, I went to check on their winter stores, and one immediately stung me on the face just below my eye. That is one of my least favorite places to ever be stung by a bee, let me tell you. It had been pretty cold here, lows in the teens to 20s and highs in the 30s for the last week or so, but today it warmed up into the low 60s. I have two hives, one a 10 frame with deep and medium, and the other is a 5 frame nuke. Nuke is short for nucleus. That means it's a tiny hive with all the components in it. Both have rapid round feeders with dry sugar on them, so I wasn't actually going down into the hive, just opened the top to look into the feeders. Both hives had a lot of activity out front, and it looked like they were doing orientation flights. I did not have a veil on, as I did not think I would need it for as little as I was going to be messing with them. Do you think that their defensive nature was just because of the time of year, or is it possible that their general disposition has changed for some reason? Both hives are about 18 inches off the ground. Shouldn't be any concerns for small predators pestering them. Any larger, both hives had full feeders with only a few bees in the rapid rounds, perhaps just exploring on this warm day. So here's the thing. This is a very familiar story. Even seasoned beekeepers do this. You let your guard down, it's cold outside, they don't seem like they should be flying. Don't take it personal. I've gone out there to look at the bees. I've learned to put just a hat with a veil on, even for those quick looks in the wintertime, because as described here, you might be just checking on the food stores. Well, until you pull the lid off of your rapid round feeder, what's that look like for those of you who don't know? Looks like this, sits right on the inner cover, and the bees are contained. They can't get up through here. And hopefully, if you're following my lead this year, above this box where this is contained, you've got a polystyrene or some insulated cover above it. So anyway, you pull it off, and normally when there's syrup in it, you have this inner clear piece that keeps the bees from floating out into the syrup. It also prevents them from having to try to dehydrate that entire surface in there. So this is the winter configuration. Poured in here would be dry sugar. Cane sugar is what I recommend. Some people like to use fondant and things like that. You can put chunks of fondant in here. So now when you open it, there's an open column through the center. The bees can come right out because they're all open here. So the minute you lift this off, you're exposed to the bees. It is an extremely common story that one very calm little worker bee that just happens to be up here will fly calmly onto you and deliver a sting. Even though you weren't doing anything necessarily challenging to the bees, you didn't vibrate it, you just exposed it, their heat's running out, and you're checking on this. So, you know, actually, they would be way ahead if they made these covers transparent. Or if you cut out a little section of it and put a little square of plexiglass just so you could look in there without opening that, you might be well ahead. Plus, you're not venting off any of their warm air when you do it. Food for thought. That just struck me right now. But anyway, don't take it personal. There are a lot of new beekeepers that want their bees to like them. Everybody wants their bees to like them. They want to be tolerated by their bees. And when one comes out and stings you, the ultimate compliment, it gave its life to sting you. Because once that stinger's in there, you're done. So the thing is, I highly recommend wearing at least a veil when you go out, even in the wintertime, to pop the covers to look at your feed resources. Another thing I want to add while we're talking about this today is you should have feeder shims on all of your beehives. And this is the time of year. This is the northern hemisphere. So in the south, you're in summer already, so this doesn't matter, southern hemisphere. But dry sugar at a minimum. Dump that into these. You go out there with your big bags of cane sugar and pour it in there. If they use it, great. You know, then they needed it. If they don't use it, nothing is lost except for the cost of a bag of sugar, which later can be mixed with water and used as syrup in the spring. So it's a win-win. It's an insurance policy. Hopefully they have enough honey to keep them going. But if they don't, and they don't have sugar on, you want it on early. You don't want to wait until they're desperate. So anyway, that's it. I'm not worried about it. Don't be insulted. Your bee doesn't dislike you. They're just suddenly exposed to bright light. Keep in mind, when you pop the lid of that, they're going from total darkness to bright midday light. A warmer day, there's some activity. They're also defensive. We're going to talk about that a little bit too. Because what else happens on these warm days and the bees can fly? They look for resources. Robbing situations can happen. And if they've been robbed the day before, they're on the defensive for an extended period of time. So let's move on to the next one. This is from Kara. State is Kansas. This is our first winter as beekeepers, and we live in south central Kansas, and the weather has been unseasonably warm, with some days getting into the high 50s, lower 60s. We have Saskatrass bees, and they've been flying in those days. They are bringing in quite a lot of pollen. But we have no idea where they could be getting it, as nothing is in bloom. All plants are what you would expect in the middle of winter, dead or dormant. Have any clue where the bees could be getting pollen this time of year? Yeah, I do, and I had the same situation. This is pretty funny because, you know, not right now, but late into October, bees were bringing in pollen from places I had no idea. Another thing I might have speculated is that somebody might be putting out pollen substitute. But what if you want to know, for your area, could there be pollen? Where would it be? What would the source be? Would it be trees? Would it be grass? Would it be weeds? Or would it be fungus? Yeah, because think about it. There's even little pollen particles that are coming off of fungi, which are mushrooms. Now, how would you know? Well, I'm going to give you something to look up. So if you want to get your pen ready to write this down, you look at what people with allergies are concerned about. And I have several allergy apps on my phone. Because, not because I have allergies, I'm an NKA, no known allergies, as they say. But there's an app called Pollen Wise, P-O-L-L-E-N, Wise, W-I-S-E. If you load that app on your phone, you can look at the forecast for pollen. What's good about that app and why I like it? Right now, today, even though pollen loads across the board, grasses, weeds, trees, fungus is the highest, but they had a listing for birch trees right now. In fact, they said the pollen from the birch would be a 10, which is very low, by the way, at 12 a.m. So not only do they tell you the source of the pollen, they tell you when it's going to be at its peak, what time of day, and they forecast a 12-hour forecast, 24-hour forecast, and a 3-day forecast. And the levels are very high, moderate, or low. Now, the way this works is the sensor that's telling you about the pollen could be actually hundreds of miles away from where you currently live. So this is a company that is trying to get more pollen sensors spread throughout the United States, but they need sponsors to do it. And but if it's in the same kind of latitude as you, and it gets the same kind of weather as you, and it's in proximity, it can give you an update. And what was fun is last summer, when I would look at the app and see that certain trees would have high pollen counts on specific days, or ragweed or something like that, which people that suffer allergies hate ragweed. Ragweed is one of the weeds that produces pollen, and the bees don't get any nectar from it. They just fly over there and they get the pollen alone and they fly back. So there's no nectar reward for the energy spent going to gather that pollen. So the thing is, I looked at the bee landing boards on days when they said pollen would be low. And as would be expected, the number of pollen loads that were coming in would be somewhat reduced. And then on the days that they said the pollen would be considered very high, go out to your bee yard and see if you can match this prediction up with what actually happens in the bee yard, and guess what? 9 times out of 10, the production of pollen coming in was also very high. So you can actually predict which days your bees are going to have the biggest pollen load. Why would that matter to you? Well, one, it lets us know that there is pollen in the environment, that it could be coming in, and the bees are going to use it for bee bread. The other thing is, if you're one of the people that likes to put out pollen traps to collect bee pollen, bee gathered pollen that has a little bit of their mandibular gland material contributed to it to make it sticky so that it will stick onto their hind legs. So it hasn't been made into bee bread or anything, because you're going to interrupt it as they're going into the hive. But days that are predicted to be the highest pollen days are days when you could put a pollen trap out and collect some of that pollen and then pass it on to your friends that have those seasonal allergies and have them sprinkle that onto their salads or whatever. But anyway, that's the app, Pollen Wise. It's very, very interesting, helpful. And the reason I like it again is because they actually name the tree species. They name the weed species. But when it gets to fungus, they're not saying what the source of the fungus is. So it's not naming specific mushrooms and things like that, which actually could be beneficial to the bees. And something I would personally be interested in, but they don't break it down that much. And again, it's designed for pollen allergy sufferers, But as a beekeeper, it's a nice tool too. So right now, for me, what could they be dealing with? And I'm in the state of Pennsylvania, Northwest Pennsylvania. They're dealing with birch. So they could be, they're not flying because it's too cold out there right now. But if we had one of those breaks where it was in the 60s, I would be looking at my pollen app to see what they might be bringing in. And guess what? There it would be. Pretty good stuff. Next one is from Tom Hines, New Haven, Connecticut. I have three hives. They are about 50 feet from the back of my house. I have a south-facing window on the back of the house that has two window boxes under it. I've noticed that as soon as the temperature hits the low 40s, the bees come out and head for these two window boxes. They look to be digging around in the soil for something, but what? I know that they must be enjoying the sun and the heat coming off of the house. I put a large flower pot in this with the same soil right next to the hives and even dipped it or tipped it so it faces the sun, but they don't go near it after it snowed. I went out and brushed the snow off the window box, and as soon as it warmed up, they're back digging around. Could this also be a sign that they're lacking something? Okay. So they're digging in the soil. The other thing is, I would love to see pictures of these bees. And the reason is, there's a very good chance they might not be honeybees. Unless we can physically see them. Now they're flying at the bee boxes. This is actually a really cold day. The sunshine stimulates them to do stuff. We have a reflective south-facing wall of the house with windows, which when the sun hits that, heats the soil right in front. Is there any chance that these could be mining bees? Because sometimes they are known to come up and emerge from the ground. Because it's the thing that's curious to me about this is they look to be digging around in the soil. Mining bees do that, and they can look very similar to honeybees. They're solitary bees. But when they come up out of the soil, they do it in clusters, which can, I've had people actually say, we have a swarm of honeybees next to our house. Do you want to come and get them? And they say, well, how many, can you show me a picture of them? And what they'll do is they'll send a picture of a bunch of little fuzzy bees, but it's like a single layer of them, and they're kind of spread out on the ground near the house. And historically, that has been mining bees coming out. So those aren't honeybees swarming at all. Now, I don't want to insult anybody. I know that most people know what honeybees look like. Mining bees can look a lot like a honeybee. So if they're actually actively digging, if they're coming out of holes, you see them go into a hole that looks like a nightcrawler hole, for example, then there's a very good chance it's not a honeybee at all, unless we can see them making it back to the hive. That's quite a distance. They have to fly away from this warmed area and get back to the hive. And then go from the hive in 30 degree temperatures to the house, then go to the ground, and then dig to it. Now let's skip over that. So the other thing is, let's verify what the species of bee is. And if it's honeybees, we'll move on to the next thing. The next thing is that the soil might be damp, and also when it warms, because bees will also fly out on melting snow, and they'll drink water. Now, bees, we know, also have a preference different times of the year. This preference is not consistent all year long. They want highly mineralized water. So sometimes if you've got melting snow and it's adjacent to exposed soil and it's against the south exposure of the house like that, the water is seeping in and they might be digging in the dirt. And this is where close observation matters, because we want to see if they're sticking their proboscis in there, if the little tongue's coming out, and if they're actually gleaning moisture from the soil there, which would have a higher mineral content, which would benefit the bee's microbiome in their digestive system. So the other thing that leads me to, although this is a cold day, but I would like to suggest that some people be prepared for the warm days. And right next to the hives isn't always the best way to do that. So putting the pot, I'm not surprised that they didn't go to a pot that was right next to a hive. We have a tendency to try to make everything immediately available and adjacent to the colony so that they'll have, you know, the convenience of getting it right there. But the way the foragers work is they zip out, they do a little orientation corkscrew flight, and off they go. So they tend to ignore things immediately adjacent, unless it's a nice warm day and they have a lot of loitering time and they can really explore their immediate vicinity. But now we can put out drinkers in an area where you frequently put out resources for the bees. They have excellent memories, by the way. And so as they go out and locate a source of water that they like, because they are thirsty in wintertime too. And if they go to a water source, you can put out two types of water for them. You can have regular filtered water, not city water that's got chlorine and everything else in it, because we've shown that the bees don't like that. But if you have filtered water and put that out, I would put out at least two drinkers. This is for backyard beekeepers, small scale. Put that about 50 feet at least from your apiary. And I like to put it upwind of the bees. Now, you can also put out mineralized water. So sea salts is something that I did experiments with, practical testing. And we found out that 1 teaspoon of sea salts per 1 quart of water. So you never put that out as the only source of water. So we put out water, so we get a day when it hits 65 or 70, as was previously mentioned here, and the bees start to zing around and they forage. If they've got snow, it's going to be a snow melt. They're going to find their water, no matter what. But if there's any chance that there isn't a lot of water resource around, then you could put that out and they will show a preference for some that is mineralized, like the sea salts. It's not critical what the source of the sea salt is, but we did Himalayan pink salts, which is not sea salt. But we also did number two choice for them was Morton sea salts. So that was interesting too. 1 teaspoon per quart. So we did higher salinity amounts, we did lower salinity amounts, and the bees went towards the 1 teaspoon per quart mix. So that's something that you can do for them, and they are thirsty, and it is interesting to see honeybees out on the snow licking the melting snow with their tongues, and then when that bee gets inside, it gets mobbed by other thirsty bees that are not going outside, so they'll be taking water off of those water bees. So it's interesting stuff. So I want to know more about, through close observation, if the bees that are digging in the soil, are they also licking the soil? Because there's no function, no benefit to them just digging in soil. The mining bees would do that, but the honeybees would only be after moisture. So there's that part. Moving right along, next is Eugene Drum from Peterborough, Ontario. And here we go. I'm building 2 long lang boxes for spring. Those of you who don't know, a long lang is short for a long langstroth. The langstroth beehive is a standard vertical hive. Long langs are the horizontal format that use langstroth equipment. And I plan on using wood frames with plastic foundation. While watching your long langstroth videos, I've seen that the bees have made holes in the top corners of the frames for traveling. My question is, if I pop foundation out of the frames and snap off the corners, then reinstall upside down so that the opening corners are at the top, do you think the bees would use those holes? Okay, so here's the thing. The other thing is, for my horizontal hive, I did not put any plastic foundation in there. No plastic frames, no plastic foundation, because we're counting on the bees' ability to laterally move through the hive and get to either other frames so that they can tend to brood or to store their resources and then access those resources going horizontally through it. So I wanted them to be able to chew through. So I have 2 types of frames in my Langstroth horizontal hive. I have frames of better comb, which is soft, and the bees work it just like their own beeswax. And then the other thing was the foundationless frame, so I did one after the other. And so now they have natural honeycomb too. Both they can chew through, and that's what we showed in this. The other thing is, we did a discussion before, these are acorn frames, acorn foundation. And I bought these frames from Acorn. They came pre-stapled. They're already assembled. They're ready to go. And there is a plastic foundation in here. And this is with worker style, worker sized cells already printed into the bottom here. And that causes them to draw out worker cells. Now, they also have little perforated corners on here. And this perforated corner allows you to snap off the corner so the bees can travel through here without going under and up to the next one or over the top and down. Bees prefer to travel straight through their comb. In fact, sometimes I've seen it where it looks like the bees are going into a single cell, but then the bee doesn't come out. Another bee also goes into the single cell, and then another bee goes into a single cell, and that'll be somewhere here in the field. So they even have a tendency to cut a hole through and then travel through that frame, so it looks like a bunch of bees, kind of like the clowns in the Volkswagen or the tiny fire truck at the circus. Just so many of them come out of there. But what there really is, they made a little single cell size transit hole, which they also use for ventilation and migrating through the frames. So to answer the question, you sure can do that. But you don't have to invert it. Why not go ahead and clip all four corners? So now this is a deep frame, Langstroth frame. This is one of the ones that came with the Hoover hive that I assembled in that video, and I marked it because I like to know where my frames are coming from. Anyway, they included foundation that was heavy wax, and if you notice, it is not connected on the edges here. So when you put your foundation, your wax foundation in here that is heavy coated with wax, heavy wax coated foundation gets used by the bees first. My favorite company that makes this stuff is Acorn. So the thing is, you can pop these out. All you do is flex them through the middle and they come out of the bottom, just like that. There's a receiving groove in the bottom here. There's a receiving groove in the top. I don't glue them. I don't fasten them. So they're really flimsy. See that? They flex easy. Anyway, it's plastic. So I take 10 snips and then I can just cut the corners off. So here's one to save time. I cut the corners off of it. You got the top corners cut out, bottom corners cut out on all sides. So why not just take this piece and cut all four corners off if you want to? Then, to answer the question, will the bees close it up if they don't want it? They sure will. They also glue this all with beeswax to all the corners where it meets the sides of the frame and so on. So yeah, you could clip them all. Now generally, I talked about this with the owner, with the designer of the plastic frames. And we talked about maybe even having a punch out, like right in the middle somewhere. But guess what happened? All the bees did was plug up the punch out that's in the middle. The other thing is they filled it with drone comb. So even if it was a worker frame like this, they just make oversized cells for some reason when there's a big gap like that. So if they don't need those corners for transit, then what they'll do is they'll just make cells that way. And a lot of times the cells that they make when those gaps are left there will be drone size cells. And is that a problem? Not in my opinion. So they just snap in. Even when you buy them already in the frame, that's how easy they go in. So it's kind of a floating foundation in here. Plastic. So yeah, you can cut the corners off. It works. And so don't bother inverting it. I would just cut the corners off all four of them. Why not? You got nothing to lose. Then if they want those ventilation holes, they can use them. What's the other option? Say you don't cut them. Can they cut through the plastic? No. The very benefit of the plastic foundation is, number one, how easy it is to reuse and scrape off the drawn cells. But pests can't chew through it. So waxworms, for example, don't chew through the plastic foundation. Mice will chew them up, but waxworms don't get through. So that's pretty much it for that question. And if you can believe it, I'm already on my last question for today. This comes from Wesley, city is Calgary, Alberta, Canada. The question is regarding cleaning dead bees from the bottom board during winter. Normally I have dead bees on the snow in front of the hive, just like everybody else. Few bees almost every day. I'm running a horizontal hive with 3.5 inch insulation. These are thick walls. Because of that, I can't see too much area under the frames. Do you think there could be some indication I should use my long, narrow stick to scoop out what's on the bottom board, or just do this blindly, weekly, bi-weekly? Will this be bothering the cluster above? Thank you, and so on. Okay. Nope, because when the bees cluster, they're well off the floor. And I've done recent, I just posted photos last week, close-ups of the eyes of a worker bee and a drone to show those lenses. And I got those off of the bottom boards of my hives just by cleaning out the entrances. And true to form, of course, some of those bees you clean off of the bottom, even though they appear dead and frozen, they're away from the cluster, they're not protected, they're not warmed, they come to life and they start running around on your microscope table. So what I do is, every time you have a chance, just carry, these are barbecue skewers. These have little handles on them. Got them at Home Depot. Anytime I'm going out to the bee yard, I have these stuck in my pockets. And when I come across the entrance, I just stick these in there, scissor them together, and pull out. Always, you cannot clean out your entrance too often. It doesn't bother the bees at all. They don't care. Scoop them out. You don't have to go deep and clear it, because all you're trying to do is maintain access to this hole right here. So the bees inside, when they have dead bees that fall on the bottom that don't make it out, they have a tendency to cluster up against this hole. They can block it. And then when there is a warm day, the bees can't get out and do their flights. So your job is to get your sticks in here and scrape out that opening so that the bees on the inside, when they do get that warm day, can get right through that opening. Plus it's vented. Dead bees on the inside, collecting a bunch of them out of there, I would not pull your entrance reducer. That will get your bees active inside. So, and hopefully your opening is wider than this one. This is just a sample. But cleaning them out so that two things happen through that entrance. One, they're venting through it. Number two, it's their egress location. So they can come through and haul out dead bees on a really warm day when they really get active. We need them to be able to escape the hive. So there is no overdoing that. So every time I'm out there, scoop them out and keep it clear. It doesn't have to be deep. And then on a really good day, they'll be hauling out their own dead and tossing those in the snow. So that is it. Clean your entrance often. Upcoming, I'm going to have a topic specific to Better Comb synthetic beeswax, the good and the bad. We're going to give a balanced presentation about that stuff. I was going to add it to today's discussion, but I thought it warranted its own. I received a message from Deborah Hewitt, who requested that I explain how people should not be using Better Comb in their hives, and many reasons for that. So I'm going to do a review of the entire year. I've been reviewing Better Comb since 2019. Now we're in 2021. So we might as well talk about what we've learned and what the bees do and don't do with it, and some good ideas about why, when, and how you might want to use Better Comb or not. So there's a lot to do with that. Put your finishes on your beehives now. If you haven't, this is the fluff part, by the way. The question and answer period is over, so we're just shooting the breeze now. So as I said before, this is a great time to be putting hive bodies together, checking things out. If you don't want to put a finish on a hive, you don't want to be bothered with that, you kind of have two choices. One is the material. So if you get cedar hives can be unfinished, and they'll last many, many years. The other thing is, I'm really glad that I found the Hoover hives, because they come pre-finished, pre-waxed, ready to go. So I'll be evaluating that through the year. The company that sells the Hoover hives, where I got those, they also sell Amish-made hives that are not much different in price than the Hoover pre-waxed hives. And some people commented on the video that, yeah, they tell you that those are Amish, and they're not made by the Amish. Well, they're not deceptive about that at all. The Hoover hives are sold separately on the same site. They have Amish hives over here. They have the Hoover hive. And those are pre-waxed and ready to go. So if you don't want to fool with finishing and you want a natural finish, so other than the undercoating, which may have some other wax, so not beeswax, it may be another material that soaks in. Even Cayman Reynolds, when he does his, I think he uses it other than beeswax. I think they use other stuff because it's cheaper. Plus, it has the properties that cause it to soak into the grain of the wood better. And then the final coat is what's actually 100% beeswax. So that's another thing to look at, a pre-finished hive that's ready to go. Other people don't like the idea that they have a finish on the inside. So these are just ideas for you. So put your finish on, get your painting done now, let everything dry out really well. And don't forget today, there are 91 of these episodes now. So go ahead and click the thumbs up down in the bottom there to remind yourself that this is one you've already seen. If you didn't have time to watch the whole thing or any of these episodes, but you'd like to listen, don't forget to pop in and go to the podcast and become one of the 15 people that is following that there. So, and if you can't find the podcast, go to www.thewaytobe.org, and there's a page, podcast. All of them are on there. And if you click follow on the podcast, anytime there's a new one added, let's say I have an idea and I just want to talk about it. I don't want to make a video. I just want to talk. I might just put a podcast out to discuss that. Or what if I want to talk to somebody? What if I want to interview someone about beekeeping? The president of my beekeepers association or something. We would put that on the podcast as well. So you may not want to miss out on the way to be. Could be information that you find beneficial. And that's it. You're invited to subscribe if you're not a subscriber already. And I'm glad you were here today. I hope that 2021 is a fantastic year for you. The other thing is, don't wait. If you're a brand new beekeeper and you've got your hives all set, you picked out your site to put your beehives and everything else, and when spring comes, you're going to order those bees. You need to, I highly recommend that you find a source for your bees now, put in your order now. Because people that sell nucleus colonies, package bees, you can't just buy a queen if you don't have other bees for them to be put together with. So this is a point of frustration for people that are trying to get the bee weaver queen bees, because that's what I will bring in. If I need a replacement queen this year, it will only be bee weaver queens, but you already have to have your bees to do that. So if you're buying packages, if you're picking Russians, Purdue ankle biters, if you know, these bees that have very good survival traits and things like that, they're going to be in demand. Pick reputable breeders. So listen to people and where they've received their bees, what the condition of the bees was, what kind of parasite loads they might have had, how well they've done over a period of two or more years. I know that's hard because if your friends just got their bees last year, they're just going through their first winter. We don't yet know how well those bees are going to perform. So people that get bees and have gotten them through a couple of years, then they could really say, yeah, they're working great. Because here's what happens. Often the bees that you get, the line of bees that you're using, may seem to do really well the first year, may make it through winter and do okay coming out of winter, but it's the second winter that they tend to decline and fail and start to demonstrate that they really aren't the survivors that you were hoping that they would be. So this is where you depend a lot on what other people have to say about the lines of bees that they keep, and try to keep bees that are regionally capable, those that are already matching up the rhythm of the environment that you have. And that's pretty much all I have to say about that. But don't be disappointed and wait till the last minute and try to buy packaged bees. So that's it. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you for being here today. If you have questions, write them in the comment section down below. And I hope you have a fantastic New Year's Day. Thanks for watching.